the tent or tabernacle of God in salvation history and its progressive development. Despite the fact that the Israelites went after strange gods, immediately after the ratification of the covenant, and went astray from the God of covenant again and again, God always remained faithful to His covenant. His intention to dwell in a tent in their midst was an unfailing sign of His fidelity. And that tent had to be built exactly according to the prescriptions of God, Exodus 25:9. The material needed had to come as contributions from the people, Exodus 25:1-7. The book of Exodus reserves 11 of its 40 chapters to the prescriptions given by God and the realization of the tent, Exodus 25:31 and 35:40. In four scenes, the tent or tabernacle and its progressive development are presented here. 1. The tent or tabernacle of God in Exodus. The structure of the tent God asked Moses to build had to be amid the tents for the people, but distinct from it. At its center had to be the ark where the tablets of the Decalogue were kept, and over it the mercy seat covered by two cherubims. It was the Holy of Holies. It had to be divided by a curtain from the holy place, in which had to be set the altar of incense, the lampstand, and the table of bread offered to God. In the court in front of it, found a laver for purification and an altar for burnt sacrifices. The ark had to be set in such a way as it could be transported from place to place. Its poles and rings had to remain in place always. The materials prescribed for the Holy of Holies were to be fine gold and precious linen, symbolic of God's sanctity and majesty. The tent was intended to be a place where God's presence, not a permanent one though, was established under the sign of clouds. God manifested His glory from there and revealed His will to the people through Moses. It was an indirect presence and not a direct one. The prophets foretold the future dwelling of God with His people forever. Ezekiel 37:27, "My dwelling shall be with them." And Zechariah 2:14, "I will come to dwell among you." Those prophecies on God's perennial dwelling among His people were fulfilled in the New Testament with the coming of the Messiah. There are three pertinent New Testament texts which particularly serve our purpose: John 1:14, 1 John 1:4, and Revelation 21:3. Second, Mary, the tent of God. But before proceeding to the New Testament texts, we should ponder over a special tent where God established His presence in a human person. It is interesting to note that the presence of God moves here from a place to a person. That person was the tent prepared by God for His Son, God with us, and that tent was Mary of Nazareth. Over 7 centuries before Christ, Isaiah spoke of that tent. The virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. 7:14. Speaking of the incarnation, Paul wrote, "When the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman." Galatians 4:4. God prepared that woman immaculate from the conception on and filled her with his grace. Luke 1:28. He chose her to be the mother of his son. She was told by God's messenger Gabriel, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born of you will be called Holy, the Son of God." Luke 1:35. And all the glory Mary, the tent of the Son of God, possessed, came from God's choice of her. Though Mary is not directly called the tent of God in the New Testament, the fathers of the church found in her the true tent of God's indwelling. Saint Dionysius wrote in the 3rd century, "As Christ our priest was not chosen by hand of man, so neither was his tabernacle formed by men, but was established by the Holy Spirit and by the power of God, is that tabernacle protected, to be held in everlasting remembrance, Mary, God's Virgin Mother." Saint Ephrem, in his prayer to the Virgin Mary, calls her the Holy Tabernacle. He qualifies her first the temple of the Son of God, and then she is that mystic new heaven in which the King of Kings dwells. Hippolytus thought in the same line when he wrote in the 5th century, "Jesus was the ark formed of incorruptible wood. For by this is signified that his tabernacle, Mary, was exempt from defilement and corruption." Like the people of Israel carried with them the Ark of the Covenant on their way to the Promised Land, Mary, overshadowed by the power of God, Luke 1:36, carried in faith Jesus from the moment of conception until his birth in Bethlehem. She showed him to humanity. She lived for him and followed him throughout his life. Thus, she became the model for the pilgrim church and example for all who followed Jesus in their lives. 3. God's dwelling among us in the Gospel of John. One of the central verses in the New Testament about the indwelling of God is in John 1:14. "The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, the glory such as belongs to the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth." This verse is the climax of the entire hymn to the Word, Logos, in John. The hymn, as it is given in John 1:18, is most probably an adaptation and interpretation of a hymn to the Word that existed in Christianity before John's Gospel was written. As it stands now, three sections in the hymn could be traced. Verses 1-5, the pre-existent being of the Word, Logos. Verses 6-13, the coming of the Word to humanity, the incarnation being already hinted at, and its incomprehensible rejection by humanity. Verses 14-18, the event of the incarnation and its meaning for the salvation of believers. Verses 2, 5, 6 to 8, 12 to 13, 17 to 18 could well be additions of John. Verse 2 is a repetition and reinforcement of verse 1b. Verse 5 introduces the contrast which John in his Gospel repeatedly sets between darkness and light. Verses 6 to 8 introduce John the Baptist. With that, Evangelist hints to the historical coming of Christ with the witness John the Baptist. Verses 12 to 13 show the preoccupation of John about the unbelief which greeted the coming of the light into the world. Verses 17-18 contain further reflections of the evangelist and a theological confession. After affirming the pre-existence of the Word, his role in the universal creation, the historical witness to the Word made flesh in the person of John the Baptist, the refusal of the Word from the part of humanity, the hymn presents its climax in 1:14. It expresses the unmistakable paradox that the Word, who dwelt with God, clothed in the full majesty of the divinity and possessing the fullness of divine life, entered the sphere of earthly and human, the material and perishable, by becoming flesh. This is an altogether new and unique event in human history. The Word had already been present and active in the world, even though he met with rejection from humanity, but now the incomprehensible takes place. Right in the middle of humanity which rejected the Word, he comes down, becomes man, and pitches his tent among men. Hitherto he was in glory with the Father. Now he takes on the lowliness of human earthly existence. Formerly he was with God, but now he pitches his tent among men and in human form in the full reality of the flesh. The incarnation, the coming of the flesh of the eternal Word, takes place so that mankind on earth may be brought heavenly revelation and divine life. The way of the Redeemer down to the flesh and his way upwards through flesh to heavenly glory also becomes a way for all who attach themselves to him in faith. In Johannine terms, flesh expresses that which is earthbound, transient and perishable, the typically human mode of being, as it were, in contrast to all that is divine and spiritual. It is a new and profound way of confessing the Savior who has become palpable in history as a unique, personal human being who has manifested himself in the reality of the flesh. The fundamental affirmation of the Incarnation must also be borne in mind in the phrase, "He pitched his tent among us." The Word, despite the rejection from the part of humanity, sets up his tent among us in a new and unique way. among us means no more and no less than among human beings collectively. The Word, the light for every man, came in the flesh for all human persons. But the evangelist undoubtedly voices here, as in 1 John 1:1-3, his own experience of a believer based on immediate fellowship with the incarnate Word. Part of that experience was seeing His glory, such as belongs to the only begotten from the Father. The phrase "full of grace and truth" is attributed to the Word made flesh, and that in concrete means that the incarnate Word bears in Himself the fullness of grace and truth. While the hymn to the Word in the Gospel of John speaks of the perennial presence of God among humanity and at the center of the cosmos, the hymn to the Word in the first letter of John, 1:1-14, speaks of the Word made flesh as a God to listen to look upon, and to touch. The intention of the author here is to introduce the fellowship the Word made flesh establishes between God and humanity and the Christ experience He imparts. Between God's presence in the tent of God in Exodus and God's indwelling among us in John, there are clear differences and remarkable superiority. First of all, the dwelling of the Word made flesh among men is not a man-made structure like in Exodus. Instead, it is the very presence of the Son of God. His dwelling is not limited to the space of a tent, but is universal. One could say the entire cosmos, the dwelling place of God's only begotten Son. The dwelling of God in John is not an indirect one, covered with clouds, but a direct one. The presence of God in the tent of Exodus was transitory because it moved from place to place, whereas the indwelling of the Word made flesh is perennial. Above all, the presence of God in the tent of Exodus did not create communion between God and man, but the indwelling of God among men in John creates the communion between God and man. The author of the letter to the Hebrews states the superiority of the New Testament covenant over the Old Testament covenant and speaks of the tabernacle made by God. 9:11-12. One important observation to be made here is that the indwelling of the God made flesh among us in the incarnation creates communion between the only begotten Son of God and the believers. In the letter to the Hebrews, the tabernacle becomes the locus or venue of redemption itself. 4. The final tent of God in the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation presents the culmination of the concept of the tent of God in the salvation history. In verses 21:1-3 we read, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, God's dwelling is with the human race. He will dwell with them, and they will be His people, and God will be always with them as their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no death or mourning, wailing or pain, for the old order has passed away." Later in the same chapter, the author writes, I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb. The city had no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gave it light, and its Lamb is the Lamb. The tent or tabernacle, which had its origin almost at the beginning of salvation history, and exactly in the book of Exodus, leads us to a far superior and a tent of fulfillment at the end of the Bible and in the book of Revelation. The vision of the tent in the book of Revelation is the ultimate destiny of humanity as God wanted it. A tent where God is enthroned among His people along with a victorious Lamb. We can note the final renewal of the covenant in verse 21:3. The text continues to present the God of conciliation, God who wipes out the tears from human eyes, God who exterminates death or mourning, wailing or pain. That tent is filled with the glory of God. Humanity as such, and each one of us, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, is on a pilgrimage to that tent of consolation and joy. At the center of that pilgrimage stands God's perennial indwelling among us in the Word made flesh. May each one of us and our dear ones, near and far, be encouraged and animated in faith by the indwelling of the Emmanuel among us during this Christmas season and throughout the year 2014.
True.